I want to jump into the digital space of events. So tell me everything we need to know in 30 seconds. Go. Just kidding. Okay. So if I have no idea where to start, let's say that I am used to collecting major funds in events and galas, walks, meet and greets, even just cultivation and stewardship engagement. What should I do to get started?
So I do things really differently.
Okay.
I
shake it up.
Yeah, I shake
That's
it
why
up.
You're I don't, on the podcast, lady.
I don't like, as my dog here is trying to get me to play ball.
Oh, the dog's welcome too.
You're welcome.
I've become
too,
a
bud.
Dog lover during COVID. So this is like groundbreaking in my family. I've been a cat person forever and dogs like just not so much. Nothing against them. It's just that they were like a different thing. And when they are so loud and barking and coming up and wagging and licking and everything, it was just not doing it for me. But my neighbor got a puppy and I'm now a dog person. I'm now like the first to get on the
They're
ground
the best.
And play with a dog and say, I want a dog. I love you so much.
They
so
are
Rosie,
totally
shout out
the
to
best.
The dog, Rosie.
They make you feel all the love. And actually what's interesting about that, okay, so this dives actually weirdly
segments one more
perfectly into
it.
What I'm going to say. So I always start off, I launched a course about planning engaging events. And the first thing I talk about, which a lot of people have said they keep going back to, is this kind of inverse pyramid. And the first thing I think about is don't think about like the event logistics at all. Think about what are the top of the pyramid is the emotions. What do you want the people to feel?
Oh, I like that. That's your
priority. Do you want them to be laughing? Do you want them to be emotional and kind of like sad? Do you want them to feel full of community and connection? Like what emotions throughout the event, right? You can have multiple ones, but like how do you want that to flow? And so that's the first thing. And then the second thing is impact goals. So not how much do you want to raise, but think about it in terms of what are the programs we need to fund? What are the goals we're trying, who are the people we're trying to help? Because that flips the ask, and this is what I talk about in corporate sponsorships a lot, from, hey, will you be a, which I hate this, will you be a diamond sponsor for $50,000? Like, I don't care about that. But if you say, I don't care about being diamond, but if you say, hey, would you provide 15 girls laptops for this Girls Who Code program? It will cost us about $50,000. I'm definitely going to go with the latter. And that's way harder to say no to.
Yes.
Also. So the second part, so the emotions, what do you want people to feel? B, what are your impact goals? What do you want to, that's basically like the front page of your website. That's the front page of your marketing materials. That's, this event is allowing us to do X thing or things. And then the third thing is then your numbers, like your metrics. So how many people would you like to be there? Because in the digital world, you can technically have unlimited. You can have thousands if you wanted to, if you're international or national, if it makes sense. How many email addresses do you want to collect? How many sponsors would you like to have? So then you have your metrics. So once you have that planned out, then you can go into the thinking of, okay, great. We know the emotions. Now, who do we want to be there? And what kind of event would these attendees actually like to attend? I was just talking to a nonprofit yesterday where they said it was another gala. And I was like, okay, well, who are your donors? Do they want to attend a gala? Like now at this point, we're a year in to being in this virtual world. So it was cool for the first few to be kind of bringing what you were doing in person to online. But now you really have to do something creative and innovative to stand out to get people to sign up. So now it's about, okay, what would be something really engaging and impactful and exciting? Like for instance, a lot of people, when we think about the old school galas, you had, if you had kids, you had babysitters, right? So right now there are no babysitters going over to people's homes to watch their kids, or the kids are home all day doing learning. So does it make sense now to do a more family-based digital event where they can sit next to you and they can learn about philanthropy? So the whole scope of planning an event, really changes. So that's where I start.
Yeah, Yeah, no, I think that's great. And I was listening to LinkedIn Learning. I don't know. Do you ever listen to them? Yeah, I love LinkedIn for whatever reason. I just feel like that's my social media place of choice. Other than Clubhouse, I've started doing these Wednesday morning, 8 a.m. Pacific time, shout out, like coffee chats with fundraisers
on Clubhouse?
And donors on Clubhouse.
Ooh, okay. I have to join you.
Please do. Becky was on today from We Are For Good. John couldn't make it, but he was there last week. And we have like frontline fundraisers. We have events people. We have corporate donors. We have foundation donors. We have Bitcoin app acceptance type owner, business company owners. I don't know how to put that into my smooth like story. We have a lot of consultants. I'm a fundraising consultant. So it was really cool. This is the second session today, and today being the day we're recording, which is not going to be the day that you're going to hear this, whoever's listening. But we're going to be doing it every single Wednesday at 8 a.m. Pacific time. So Dana, I'd love for you to come.
Awesome.
And we just do a topic that is, let's do ask the expert, what do we need to do for virtual fundraising events?
Yeah, that'd be really fun.
Yeah. So come to that. And it's a bit of a promo there, but it was a tangent to just say that I was listening to LinkedIn Learning, and this presenter was talking about how we just really need to pivot from exactly what you said. Don't try to approach your events like they were in person and you just happen to be doing virtual right now.
Cheers.
Just shift it. Cheers. Oh man, you're having wine. I'm having tea.
It's 7:30 on the East Coast. So
oh yeah, you're on the
PM,
East Coast.
Everyone, PM.
Are you sure? That's good. Okay. So Dana, what I learned was that you should really be thinking about how are you using interactive spaces. So like a Google Doc. He said a lot of the apps nowadays, they do have their own platforms for how you can do breakout sessions and brainstorming, but go back to the basics of a Google Doc or a Google Drive so you can see the changes and you can see participation and attendance. He also recommended that you do any kind of engagement like every 10 minutes or so, whether it's a poll or survey or clap or raise your hand, because folks are just kind of moving and getting distracted and looking at their phone and, you know, cleaning their apartment, whatever it is. He said, camera on. That was like the most important. He said, camera on, mic off. What other tips do you have? Like, what are your thoughts about how do you actually take something that we've all known as in-person events to virtual events after a year of learnings?
Yeah, those are great tips. I think the engagement is key throughout. And really, I think my number one is no Zoom.
No Zoom. Oh, really?
No
okay,
Zoom.
Okay, what do you recommend then? And why?
I say no Zoom because think about basically every meeting we have all day is in Zoom.
Yeah.
So if you're entering Zoom for a fundraising capacity, you're like, you're not in the mindset to give.
Wow.
So okay. You want to stay, you're in work zone.
Yeah.
Right. So you want to get them out of that, get into something fresh. Number two, do not pre-record your entire event.
Oh, please don't do that. Oh my gosh. I've been advising my clients. I'm like, please don't make me do that. I will not listen. I do not have the brain span capacity.
I've seen a lot of them that way. And I'm like, no, like, you can tell. It's very blatantly obvious when that
I
happens.
Think a few segments, like if you really need, like if you have a celebrity or you have something that you really need to have done perfectly, then you can do a few recorded, but it's got to be like the majority in person, right? Or live.
Right, right. You're saying, or we're going to go to a quick video. And I would say any pre-recorded segments, you really don't want them to be longer than a minute and a half, maybe.
A minute and a half. Okay.
Yeah, keep them really short. I love his idea, constantly engagement in the chat. Mm-hmm. A fun one that I did on a previous event that we produced is we had multiple raffle items based on engagement.
Nice.
So at the very end, we would say, we're going to announce the raffle winner based upon engagement. Keep that going. And then we would showcase that item throughout. And then literally there was somebody on the side plugging in people's names that were commenting to a random name picker online for free. So that's a fun way to keep.
Oh, that's cool.
Active.
What was the platform? I love that idea.
There's one called I think it's Name Wheel. I just used it today. Wheel or Wheel Generator, something like that. If you Google it, you should be able to find it. And it's really fun actually, because if you end up showing it on the screen to people to let them know that you're legitimately doing it from scratch, it's like a wheel that spins and then it picks it for you, and then it comes up with like confetti for the person who won. So it's kind of a fun visual.
I love it. Anything that's new and different.
Yeah. Another tool I really love is called Hopier.
Hopier.
H-O-P-P-I-E-R.
Okay.
And they're great because essentially it's great for sponsorships and for your participants. They create this virtual credit card that, let's say you have a sponsor that comes on for $10,000.
Okay.
And you're going to say, I'm going to pull 2,000 of that for event participation for this thing. So you can give every attendee their own little virtual credit card that they get to log in. And let's say every person gets $20. And you, as a nonprofit, you can brand the credit card with the sponsor's logo, with the colors.
Oh my goodness.
And you can pick the vendors of which they get to use it for.
Aha. So that's where your bio of conscious consumer comes in.
Yes.
So then you're partnering with specific vendors that you believe are good or that you want to support because they've supported you.
Yeah. And you can theme it. So they have, for example, let's say something that's been popular is virtual 5Ks.
Okay.
So if you're doing virtual 5Ks, let's say you do the virtual credit card for $20, you can select Athletica, Nike, Under Armour, Amazon as those, as your vendors. And so now if I am an attendee, I'm like, wow, oh my gosh, they just gifted me $20 to prep for my event, or it can be a training app that you can download. And you're like, wow, that's so cool. This sponsor, now I'm going to remember them, just allowed me to purchase this really cool outfit that I'm now going to wear for my virtual 5K.
Oh my gosh, Dana, I really love that. I don't know that I would have ever thought of that. My expertise is more like major gift communications, relationships, fundraising, capital campaigns. Events is not my thing. And I'm so excited to hear that. That's a really great learning. Thank you for sharing that.
It's a really fun platform. Yeah, of course, I'm just geeking out on all of the tools and platforms that are popping up. They're so good.
What are the platforms that you like? What's the default? Okay, so I just want to circle back to this. So for anybody who is panicking and like, oh no, we're using Zoom, what should they use?
Okay, a couple options.
Okay.
I love Run the World.
Nice.
Have you heard of them before?
Nope.
Okay, Run the World's great. They allow you to do breakout rooms. They allow you to do cocktail hours one-on-one where they automatically match people.
Nice.
So that's fun.
Breakouts into one-on-ones, I love those.
Then you can come back.
Okay.
You can also do breakout rooms, so based on certain topics. So if you want people to have a conversation, you can do that. Another one is give butter, not better, but butter.
Okay.
Putting butter on some bread. Okay. They're totally, actually Run the World and Give Butter both have totally free options.
Nice.
Give Butter is really fun. They allow you, when you're making your donation, they have kind of a social media looking comment bar where you can add GIFs and videos and emojis that's like playing while you're having your live presentation in front of you, which is nice. Really great. Remo, R-E-M-O, is a good one. And that one, if you can visualize being plopped down into a conference room, there's a bunch of tables
that
you get sat at, so you can have kind of your networking, like, I don't know, 30 minutes, 20 minutes. And then you can take over the screen and have your presentation. And they have little lounges on the sides for sponsors to pop in and have videos play.
For sponsors? Oh my goodness.
I know. And you can brand that whole experience too. Oh my gosh, there's so many. I have a list actually on my website where I list my top 7, I think. I keep expanding.
We'll go to the website. So what do you do if you have a celebrity who's supposed to attend the event and then they pull out last minute? What if they can't make it? How do you pivot in terms of virtual, run of show reordering? Have you had that experience yet?
So good question. No, but I've worked with a lot of celebrities in the past. I used to be a digital producer on American Idol. Random fun fact.
That's a great fun fact.
So I worked with all of the judges and talent, which was really fun.
Nice.
I would say if they're pulling out, is there a different way to engage with them?
Okay.
So one might be, okay, they can't make that event. Would they do an Instagram live with you ahead of time?
Mm.
And you can make that like a little pre-cocktail hour and say, okay, everybody, thanks so much for joining us. And then you get massive reach. We're going to shift over to our live event now.
Right.
or even a week ahead of time, will they do some promo thing okay. for you?
Okay.
So basically asking them, is there another fun way that you can work together?
I like that idea. You know, somebody actually mentioned to me in one of the Clubhouse chats that you should do a post-event Clubhouse. So you can have a debrief. So you can say, okay, the party's not over yet. The program is, but hop over to our channel or our room in Clubhouse and tell us what you thought about it. And we can all just hang out like, you know, we're in person in a way and chat and just chit chat. And
oftentimes, actually, after. That's a good point. Oftentimes, the most important part of the event is after, because you have now all of this hype, there's all this emotion about it. And then how do you continue that feel good buzz?
Yeah,
people right, that you have the next day.
Yeah. Yeah. So what is the best way to call to action after the event? So during the event, you've been engaging them and hopefully people were excited. And then after the event, maybe they're unwinding on a Clubhouse or Insta or something like that. But what then is the next call to action? Would you tap into one more step? Because it seems like there's still energy that you can capitalize on since we are virtual, which is a little bit different than once everybody gets in their cars and leaves.
Right, right. So a couple of things. One, it depends on the size of your event, okay. I would say. But even so, and I'm on my computer trying to look it up. Yes, I'm right. Okay, videoask.com is amazing.
Okay.
Essentially, you can record a video that can go out to one or many hundreds of people. And it then asks them, they can record a video back to you. They can text reply to you. Cool. So you could literally be like, hey, wasn't last time so much fun? We had a blast. Like, we're still celebrating over here. What did you think about it? Right. And leave it as an open hanging question.
Yeah.
And then it's a beautiful, simple interface. Somebody can look it on their phone and that video can be sent via email and it knows to customize it. So it's awesome.
Cool.
And then the best part is you basically get next day testimonials from people about what the experience was like and possibly video ones.
You put that I all do over this your website with, or emails.
Yeah, exactly. The other thing I would say is, again, dependent on the size of your event and maybe the level of the donors, reach out and do some of that one-on-one outreach. Something that on a social media trick is if you're able to ask people maybe during their registration if they have an Instagram handle.
Yep.
Follow them and you can send them like a voice direct message saying, last night was so much fun, Sherry. I'm so glad you were there.
I love that.
With this latest valuable episode, we'd love to thank you for joining us on the Creating Community for Good podcast. If you found today's show valuable, simply visit our website, creatingcommunityforgood.com, to leave a review as well as to get access to additional resources and relevant links from this show. Stay tuned for more episodes.